Okay, so this is the first installment of the National Security Speaker Series this year, and I'm really pleased to have my good friend, Professor Robert Ross, from Professor of Political Science at Boston College. He's also an associate at the John King Fairbanks Center for Chinese Studies at Harvard, and a senior advisor of the Security Studies Program at MIT. I just think of him as one of the preeminent China slash IR studies people in the world. So I wish I could do that, and you can write your ticket. So I hung out with him in Beijing and in Oslo because he ran a conference for a book that we're putting together. It's coming out next year, I suppose, that he's putting together, but I'm on a chapter in there. Anyway. Professor Ross's research focuses on Chinese security policy, East Asian security, and U.S.-China relations. His recent publications include Chinese Security Policy, Structure, Power, and Politics. He has a famous edited volume, really, China's Ascent, Power, Security, and the Future of International Politics. And he's published in all the leading journals, whether it's World Politics, Security Studies, International Security. So, I mean, if you're interested in China's foreign policy, you know Bob's work. Anyway, it's a great pleasure to have him. I want to get him in. I want to get him out of here so he makes his plane. So we're going to stop at precisely 4:30. We cannot go over 4:30, maybe even 4:25. Okay, thanks.
Well, let's see. I've never used PowerPoint in my life, so that makes me something of a Neanderthal, but I bet there's an on-off switch on here somewhere. Already on. Look at that. All right. Well, first I want to thank Randy for getting me out here. In an age where qualitative research and security studies have both become something of pariahs in the world of political science, the Mershon Center is an important institution that's holding the flag high, and I always thought it was one of the preeminent places that continues to do important work on security studies. So it's a pleasure to be here. Pleasure to be here with Randy. Randy has the lead article in the book we're doing, and Randy's one of the articles that will make the book a success, I assure you. Now, what I want to talk about today is the rise of China and the implications of the power transition for East Asian peace. I do not believe war is determined by structure. I believe that those who say that it is a deterministic outcome of rising powers are giving a rather simplistic view of war. War is caused by many things. Leaders matter, politics matters, nationalism matters, a lot of things matter. But I will tell you that power transitions inevitably make things worse. I think that has to be a given. How much worse is something else again. Contention over zero-sum objectives intensifies as rising powers want more, and status quo powers don't want to give it up. And in this case, the U.S.-China power transition is not an exception. As the gap narrows, relations will get worse. Indeed, U.S.-China relations today are worse than any time since 1971 when Henry Kissinger went to China. And I would suggest the fundamental reason for this is the rise of China. Now, I think we can see the implications of this most clearly in the distribution of capability between China and the United States over the last 4 or 5 years. I think we have seen dramatic change in the distribution of capabilities in East Asia, making the U.S.-China relationship increasingly precarious. Now, many of you may have read the recent article by Biddle and his colleague in International Security on China's ability to use anti-ship radar systems to create an anti-access capability in the South China Sea, and he's fairly optimistic that this will not succeed and Americans to sustain his alliances. I will tell you now that I think that article is simply wrong, and that an optimistic view of the U.S. presence in the South China Sea would be reflect a failure to understand the rise of China in the last 4 or 5 years and the implications. Simply put, that article focuses on one particular capability, China's anti-ship ballistic missile system, and to reduce China's capabilities to that one system is a problem. China has had a multifaceted rise in its capabilities with implications across the board for American presence. Now let me begin with a couple of observations. For those who are grad students and faculty in the room, I think it's important to recognize this is not the first rise of China since World War II. This is the third rise of China since World War II. The first rise began in 1949, and it took 1 year, 1949-1950. Overnight, China went from a civil war, divided, with a Chinese People Liberation Army fighting interior wars, to almost overnight a centralized government with domestic stability, a centralized revenue stream, and an army that could now face out rather than face in. In this respect, this was a quick rise from political change, reminiscent of Germany from 1867 to 1870. Some power transitions are moderate, reflect unequal rates of growth. Some are quick, that reflect political change. This was political change. The problem was that East Asia, the regional security order, reflected the colonial order. The United States replaced every colonial power in East Asia with its own power. In Korea, it replaced Japan. In Japan, it replaced Japan. In Taiwan, it replaced Japan. In the Philippines, it was still there, but it replaced Japan after the war, but that was an American colony. It replaced Japan in Singapore. It replaced the French in Indochina and replaced the British in Thailand. China was surrounded around all its perimeter, around all its territorial borders, except with the Soviet Union, by American power. And yet that strategic order did not reflect the rise of China. It reflected the old China. And what did you get? You got power transition wars. East Asia was the most violent region in the world during the Cold War. And China was the second, was involved in more wars than any other country in the world except one, and that was the United States. And every war China fought was fought on its borders. And every war it fought, it said, get off our borders. Classic power transition war, we're now powerful, get off our borders. China won every war. It won the war in North Korea. It won three wars by proxy in Vietnam and Indochina. It defeated the Indians in 1962. It won the Cold War against the Soviet Union. How do we know it won the Cold War? Because everywhere the Soviet Union had a presence and collapsed, the Chinese filled the vacuum. American presence in East Asia did not change with the collapse of the Soviet Union. China's did, because we had withdrawn to maritime East Asia. The Soviet Union wasn't in maritime East Asia. China filled the vacuums. And so it won those wars too. And at the end, it also had major success in Taiwan, compelled America to remove its forces from Taiwan and normalize relations with China, breaking with Taiwan. So at the end of the Cold War, China had won, and it was now secure, more secure than any time since 1839, the Opium Wars. Well, no wonder China was at peace. It now had secure borders. No wonder Deng Xiaoping focused on economic development, because he could. The Maoist wars were wars of national security, of power transition wars, and Mao's contribution to China today is he won those wars and provided a peaceful, secure territorial boundaries. The second rise of China was the ever peaceful rise. And that was predicated on the rise of China and its proved capabilities on the territory of continental China. And that was from aircraft, it was from missiles, and it was from ground forces. And political change developed as a result. One was Taiwan. The Taiwan independence movement is dead. People in Taiwan want independence, but they know they can't have it. Because improved Chinese capabilities have made the price of independence so high that America can't defend Taiwan from the cost of war. So Taiwan says, no matter who we elect, they have to be opposed to independence. And that includes the most recent leader. Xi has said no independence. We see it in South Korea. The last 15 or 20 years, South Korea has struggled to accommodate the rise of power as it's risen while maintaining good relations with the United States. It's struggled, but that very struggle, that very anguish that you can see in South Korea is a function of the rise of China. And that's given China a greater voice in South Korea peacefully than it had before. We're now in the third stage. This is China's third stage. The third rise of power is China is a naval power that is now challenging the United States presence and United States security in Southeast Asia. Well, let's first ask, what does China want? Well, if you look around the perimeter of China, you see U.S. bases in South Korea, Japan, Philippines, de facto aircraft carrier base that can take a 100,000-ton ship, well, that's an aircraft carrier, in Singapore. Expand American presence in Malaysia. America's now doing anti-submarine warfare against China from eastern Malaysia. That is simply unacceptable to a rising power. China has long told us, America, we don't like your Cold War alliances. And what do they mean by that? They mean they don't like our strategic presence and our Cold War allies and the implications for China's coastal security. The United States presence simply allows China, and allows the United States, to present a threat to China's coastal waters and China's coastal security. U.S. air and naval surveillance activities coming out of these bases means the United States can conduct operational activities close to China's strategic ports, most sensitive areas. Close in air and naval surveillance of Chinese naval and air operations. So China now seeks a maritime capability that can challenge U.S. naval dominance in the Western Pacific and the South China Sea. Let's be clear, China is not a status quo power. China is a revisionist power. Let's be clear, this is not a security dilemma dynamic. Security dilemma is two status quo powers that both want security, but in the quest for security, they make the other insecure. This is not a status quo power, China. This is a rising power-power transition conflict that reflects competition between a revisionist power and the status quo power. Well, I would say we're seeing a significant rise in China's naval capability. Well, first, how has it happened? Well, it's quite clear. Long-term economic growth. Over 10% growth in GDP per year for 35 years. That's going to make a difference. It makes a difference simply for the size of the Chinese economy and means a greater revenue stream for their defense budget. We've also seen technological advancement. China has been focusing very strong on replicating, copying American technology, advancing their own technology, and they've made significant gains. So in this respect, unlike the Germany of 1867, 1870, this is like the rise of Germany's second rise from 1890 onward when the Industrial Revolution gradually transformed Germany's relative power in Europe, combined with unequal rates of change in the birth rate. The French stopped having babies and the Germans kept having lots of babies. So, well, sometimes you see unequal rates of change over time, sometimes it's political change. In this case, we've been seeing unequal rates of unequal gradual change over time. But second thing that's made this possible are geopolitical trends on China's perimeter. We've seen the transformation of China's continental strategic environment fundamentally as a result as the irreversible demise of Russian power. On China's periphery, Russia was the only power that could conceivably challenge China's territorial security. Not Vietnam, not North Korea, not India. Only Russia could challenge it. Through much of the 1990s and 2000s, China remained concerned that Russia could once again challenge Chinese security. And so the preoccupation at that time was build up the PLA, make sure our borders are secure, prepare for a possible resurgence of Russian power. But in the last 5 years, the Chinese have reached the conclusion that the Russians are in irreversible decline in the Far East, and they do not have to prepare for a Russian challenge. One, we see simply the continued decay of the Russian economy. There have been no reforms carried out by Russian leaders. This economy remains a bankrupt economy. One reflection of that, another aspect of that, is this is a petrostate. That's all it is. And as a petrostate, the crash of the price of oil has sent Russia into a tailspin of a recession that they show no sign of coming out of. So compare that to China growing at 10% a year for the last 30 years. That widening gap gives China confidence. Second, the collapse of the Russian presence in the Far East. This was a part of the world that had 14 million Russians after the Cold War. Now it's down to 8 or 7 million Russians. Not only that, but the Russians who were left, they're old, like me. The young people left. They weren't going to stand around there. So this is a non-productive population in the Russian Far East that's shrinking. There's no infrastructure development. The railway that was there during the Soviet Union is still the only railway that's there, and it doesn't work very well. There are no railways, no energy, no ports, no infrastructure. Just south of that border, 300 to 400 million Chinese in a thriving high-tech economy with a massive infrastructure, roads, electricity, and a very capable ground force with military capabilities. And then the Russians have done the Chinese a favor by challenging NATO on their Western Front. First it was the Ukraine, now it's Syria and ISIS. What has this done to the Russians? Whatever good troops, whatever good equipment they had in the Russian Far East are now in the Caucasus and the Middle East. They have depleted whatever they had in terms of aircraft, in terms of soldiers, their best units, are now in Western Russia. So that since the end of the Cold War, Russia has declined precipitously, making it much less of a challenge than one ever could have imagined in 1989 or 1991, and it looks irreversible. We need to remember, since the Russians turned their attention to the Far East in the 1840s, the amount of time Russia's been a great power in the Far East, about 35 years. That's all. The first time they began a presence in Northeast Asia, and when they met a real great power in the Northeast Asia, we called Japan, and that war didn't last long. Then the Russians turned their attention to Germany 1 and then Germany 2. And then the second time they were a great power, beginning in the mid-1970s, when they increased their troop deployment, aircraft deployment, missile deployment, and that didn't last long either. The norm is that they are not a Northeast Asian power. Geography, distance, population simply makes that an unexpectable expectation, and the Chinese are watching that happen daily. Now, both of these have implications for Chinese defense spending. Over the last 35 years, you've seen Chinese defense spending grow at an average of 11% per year. That's a lot of money going in, right? Second, in the last 4 or 5 years, the annual increments of China's defense budget rise, most of that has gone to the Navy, with some to the Air Force, some to the 2nd Artillery and Missile Force. The Army is in a steady state. The Army is in a steady state because border security is fine. They don't see a challenge out there. There's sufficient border strength to maintain stability and superiority so you can begin to devote yourself to a naval presence. Now, this is clear in the evolving regional balance and the implications for military procurements. Since the early 1990s, the Chinese have been modernizing their military. And the way they've done it is they built 4 or 5 ships and stop. Learn from those ships and build a new generation. 4 or 5 ships and stop. Did that for planes, did that for aircraft, did that for missiles. Beginning about 4 or 5 years ago, they began serial production of their most advanced equipment. That's new. They've decided, they've reached a stage in military modernization that they no longer need to do 4 or 5. They're rolling out their advanced equipment today. Ships, aircraft, and missiles. One way to think about China is that China, because of the collapse of Russian power and its geostrategic environment, no longer looks like Germany, needing a large army, no longer looks like France or even Russia, and now looks like the United States. Canada on your north, Mexico on your south. Why is America naval power? Because we don't need to have a land army. China's increasingly moving in that direction because they don't see any land threat to their security. And that's transforming both their naval budget and their acquisitions. So what do we have? In 5 years, China will have a larger navy than the United States. That in itself is shocking. Now, we can talk about technology, but first let's simply say what the American Navy says. Quantity can have a quality all its own. And that is a major concern of the Navy, that we may have a technological edge. But when you get a large number of ships, they can do many things. They can be a target sponge. You only have so many missiles on a ship that can target an enemy ship. You have a lot of ships, that's a problem. They can swarm, get through U.S. defenses. So the U.S. Navy is beginning to become preoccupied with simply the size of the Chinese Navy. But second, ship production rates. China produced 60 ships in 2014, 1 year. 2 diesel submarines a year with 1 to 2 new generation nuclear attack submarines. They will possess 41 submarines in 2017, next year. They're doing 2 frigates a year, 2 to 3 destroyers a year. They are producing Well, right now they have 80, probably going up to 120, what we might call fast attack craft. Very small, very fast, could swarm in shallow waters, we call that the South China Sea, armed with anti-surface weaponry, cruise missiles, which are weapons aimed at American ships. 120 small of these ships pose a challenge to a Navy that's trying to target all ships at once. And the Chinese have a very large Coast Guard, which can be deployed with similar capabilities if necessary in time of war. All right, let's talk about technology. So they do four ships, then they're done. They do four ships, and then when they're done. Of course, when you do that, you're not really modernizing very much because you're not building a lot of ships. Well, once they start serial production, modernization is occurring. So 3% of the Chinese fleet, or I should say 3% of Chinese attack submarines in 1996, 3% were modern. 48% in 2010. 70% of their attack submarines we classify as modern in 2016. That's a hell of a rate. From 3%, then 48% 6 years ago, 70% now. And that rate of modern ship components will increase as new ships keep coming in the line and they retire old ones. They're frigates. Again, they're now producing many frigates that have air defense capabilities through anti-ship missiles, anti-air missiles that they never had before. Aircraft. 1% of the Chinese aircraft were modern in 1996, 30% in 2010, half in 2016. And the production rate is growing. Even if China maintains a growth rate of less than it is today, let's say 6 to 6.5%, they can continue that rate. Because as a share of GDP, China's defense spending is 2%. That is very low. So there's a lot China can do. Their missiles. Well, they've been modernizing their missiles. We're all concerned with the DF-21D, what do we call the carrier killer. Well, people I who know technology say the physics of it make it impossible. Over-the-horizon radar simply cannot target that kind of accuracy to hit a carrier. The atmosphere simply makes it impossible to have a circular error probability that can hit a carrier. Second of all, the container ships that cross the Pacific and in that part of the world are all about 100,000, 110,000, 120,000. So even if you can have some degree of accuracy, how are you going to know a tanker from a carrier? It's a very busy ocean. But the first point is more important. America and Australia tried to do over-the-horizon radar a number of years ago and decided it couldn't be done with adequate circular error probability. Well, where else are you going to get your radar? You can't put it on the tip of a missile. It's too heavy. So there's only one way to do it, and that's to do radar satellites. They are extremely expensive. I'd say it's just two or three of them. We don't have a lot. Very expensive. China's playing with one or two, but you need a lot. Until that time comes, the carrier is still relatively secure from anti-ship ballistic missiles. Having said that, we're focusing on the wrong issue. It's not the DF-21D, it's the DF-21C. That is a medium-range ballistic missile that can target fixed targets. Modernization. 1990, the Chinese medium-range ballistic missile had a circular error probability of hundreds of meters. Now it's 15 feet. And what does it target? U.S. bases in Japan, Philippines, and Singapore. These bases are now vulnerable to Chinese power like they never were before. DF-26 intermediate range ballistic missile can target Guam. So all this is going on in China. What's the United States doing? We're not standing still. Oh, no, actually, that's not right. No, it's true. We're not standing still. We're declining. We're getting smaller year by year as China's getting bigger. Currently, the fleet size is reducing. We currently have 273 ships. We are already doing extended deployments of our ships in order to maintain the same level of operations. The Navy doesn't have enough budgets, enough ships to do what they want to do. Attack submarines. China's are increasing. Ours are declining. We lost one this year. So we're down from 54 to 53. More important, budget constraints on future ship production. The U.S. Navy plans to increase the size of the fleet to 308 ships. and to by 2022 and to sustain that level through 2045, based on the purchase of 264 ships. According to the Congressional Budget Office, not a chance. Not going to happen. Given ship production costs, it would require a one-third increase in U.S. naval budget over this period, over average budget for the last 30 years to meet that requirement. Going forward, if the budget, let me change that, sorry. If the budget averages what it was over the last 30 years, the submarine fleet will go down from 48 ships to 54 ships, from 54 ships to 48 ships. In 13 years, we will go down to 41 attack subs. And that's if the budget is simply the average of what it's been for the last 30 years, and that, of course, includes the Cold War budget. With the average of the 30-year budget, the U.S. will purchase 192 ships rather than 264, and the fleet size will be 237 ships in 30 years, not 308 ships. China already will have a larger fleet than the United States in 4 years. Economics of greater funding. Can the United States spend more? Well, we're spending 3.6% of GDP. That leaves us room for more, according to Cold War standards. But that's an economic issue. That's like saying we could have won the Vietnam War because we were more powerful. But the outcome of the Vietnam War was decided by political issues, not military issues. So what's more, so with the military will always tell you we can do more because they're ignoring the politics. The politics is you have to redistribute the federal budget in order to do more. Well, discretionary funding is already a small part of the federal budget, and the DOD already gets 54% of the federal budget, discretionary budget. In order to redistribute, you're going to take the other 46% away from 10 other sectors in the federal budget, so they don't get much anyway. So you're going to start eliminating parts of the federal budget. Not easy to do. Reduction of non-discretionary funding? Well, our politicians are already promising to raise those fundings, to raise spending on non-discretionary, such as health care. So the likelihood that we can rearrange the budget is not good. Raising taxes is not very popular either. How about reallocating funding within DOD? Well, right now DOD is a fairly dysfunctional institution, maybe one of the most dysfunctional institutions in the world. But how do we allocate funding within DOD? One-third, one-third, one-third to the three forces. That's not a very wise way to distribute, but that's what we do, so to avoid battles between the services over budgets. Well, you think we might do one-sixth, one-sixth, two-thirds? Try getting that through the leadership of DOD, or try getting that through Congress. That's not going to happen. And you add to that veteran benefits, the high salaries of a volunteer army, all very difficult to reduce through congressional action. Compare this to China's defense budget. Lean and mean, low salaries, minimum benefits, and no wars on the periphery. And as a share of GDP, it's only 2%. It can do a lot more. We should also consider the implications of geography for China. China has more bases and better logistics in the region than the United States does. So its ability to be more operationally proactive is better than the United States. Second, those of you who remember the Washington Naval Treaties, or done research on them, well, know that the Washington Naval Treaties tried to prevent an arms race in maritime, a naval arms race, by allocating ship tonnage between, among other countries, the United States, Great Britain, and Japan. And they gave Japan, so there was a ratio for every, basically, 5 units for the United States and 5 units for Great Britain. Japan only got 3 units. They only got 3 units because they were in the region, so going in and out from their ports gave their ships more time at sea than an American ship that may have to go back to Hawaii, for example. Well, that's the situation today. Given all those ports the Chinese have in the region, an equal number of ships gives them a lot more time at sea of their ships in the United States. Technology, yes, the United States has a technological lead. That gap is closing. It's narrowing. China's working on drones. It's working on cruise missiles, it's working on satellites, it's working on nuclear submarines. We may well be able to maintain a technological gap, but it's closing. Second, we again to reaffirm, quantity can have a quality all its own. Of course, we saw that in the Korean War when we faced Chinese troops. And you can see that in naval history when the French or the Russians, particularly the French, would build lots of small ships against the capital ships of the British Navy. And the British Navy was constantly worried about the large number of small French capital ships. And of course, the Chinese can do more than the French ever did proportionally because they're not going to increase spending on their ground force and on their army. So, to repeat, China's closing the gap quickly based on economic growth, defense spending, serial production of modern equipment at a rapid rate, with a geography that benefits China compared to the United States. Compared to the United States, it has a declining budget, declining size of its fleet, severe budget constraints, and a closing or narrowing technological advantage. You can see these trends, I would argue, in great power relations today very clearly. First, let's look at U.S. defense strategy. The U.S. has given up the idea of fighting a war in the South China Sea. It is persuaded that it would be too dangerous for the United States to put its ships into the South China Sea at wartime. That's how significant the balance of power has changed, distributed the balance of force between the United States and China. We can no longer fight a war in the South China Sea. Chinese subs are lethal and numerous, and the South China Sea is a very poor ASW environment because of all the features in shallow waters, so that the noise of Chinese submarines bounce around and American sonar bounces around. So even that, even if you could have, you had your submarines in there, it wouldn't be an effective environment to deal with the Chinese fleet. Second, that DF-21, DF-26, the United States has to assume that in a wartime, we will not have access to bases in Singapore or the Philippines and perhaps Japan. The DF-26 can reach Guam. We don't know about Guam insofar as that's American territory. The Chinese may restrain themselves from attacking Guam. One would hope so. But they would have less restraint in attacking our facilities in the Philippines, Singapore, Malaysia, and Japan. And the U.S. Navy already assumes that they will have no access to those bases. Third, you know, we're all accustomed to thinking about the geography of East Asia and how the island chain pens China in so they can't get their navy out. Well, that's true. America will indeed create what we call a, we'll put SONUS capability, detection capability at the choke points where the sea lanes come through the islands. And we'll set up a picket fence with American submarines so any ship that tries to get through will not get through. But that also means the Chinese will put a picket fence on their side of those islands so we can't get in. And the American Navy knows that. They know they won't be able to get their ships into the South China Sea because of that picket fence the Chinese will set up with their own submarines. We see this also in recent U.S. strategic initiatives in East Asia. The United States is increasing its presence in Australia. Why are we doing that? Because we don't think we'll have access to our bases in the South China Sea in wartime. We just reached an agreement with India. This is an agreement to enhance logistical cooperation between the United States and India to promote humanitarian naval maritime operations. Nonsense. This is to promote logistical cooperation. The United States can use India further away from Chinese capabilities to move capabilities to the perimeter of the South China Sea. What does the United States plan to do with its carriers? It's not sending the carriers into the sea. Very clear what we're doing. We're going to deploy carriers to the northeast of the Philippines, south of Taiwan, where there are very narrow straits, and we're going to set up a picket fence so Chinese submarines can't get through, and we'll have a bastion. And we'll use the carriers to project power into the South China Sea and bring them back again. And then the carrier can go down to Australia or maybe Guam and refuel and come back again. You'll do it outside the Malaccan Straits and then project power in and go over to India to refuel. And look for Cocos Islands. All those who follow these things know that Diego Garcia is a useful U.S. base. A few years back, there was a leak in the Sydney Morning Post about U.S. and Australian cooperation to develop a U.S. presence in Cocos Island. Indonesia went nuts. We haven't heard a word about it since. I think we're developing Cocos Island, just south of Indonesia, enabling the United States to project power in and out of the South China Sea. So one can see the transformation of the balance of forces in the radical transformation of how the United States plans to fight a war. We see the implications of this closing of the power transition approaching this a nexus where operational capabilities are approaching parity with U.S. diplomacy. Now, the pivot was many things. But one of the things the pivot says, the United States will move 60% of its Navy into Asia. Why are we moving 60% of its Navy into Asia? Because less wasn't enough. We now need to put more in there to contend with the Chinese Navy. It's worth pointing out that this is 60% of a smaller fleet. That has two implications. One, it means maybe we're not going to have a larger fleet at all. It means we'll keep the fleet stable in the Pacific. But since it's a smaller overall fleet, 60% will come up without an increase. Or second, it means we're taking fleets from around the world. So I would suggest to you, with the rise of China, we're going to see the decline of America as a global naval power. For those of you who know British naval history, turn of the century, 1890s, early 20th century, Japan cut a deal with the Japanese, you get Northeast Asia. They cut a deal with the Americans, we acknowledge the Monroe Doctrine. And they took their Navy and they brought them home, first to deal with the French and the Russian navies, and then kept them there and increased the deal with the German Navy. This is what America will contend with. As the Chinese Navy rises, we're going to have to concentrate the fleet where it matters most. And American presence in the Med, in the Persian Gulf, and elsewhere will decline. China's Navy will never leave that area because it will have to keep its fleet there as well. So this will be, we see the rise of China's implications for global naval politics, global security, reflecting the decline of America's global naval power. We also see this in diplomacy insofar as the United States is resisting the rise of China and its implications for the stability of U.S. alliances in East Asia. And we're compensating, I would suggest, the way declining powers compensate by using diplomacy to establish resolve rather than having confidence in our capabilities. How do we see this? Well, first of all, we see this in American insistence that South Korea deploy the U.S. missile defense system in South Korea. A couple of points about this system. One, according to the U.S. Government Accountability Office, it still doesn't work. Missile defense doesn't work. According to the GAO, there's been insufficient testing to establish its operational capability. And then second, those reports of those tests that exist by DOD, the GAO says those reports are, how should we say, inflated with regard to how successful those tests have been. So we're deploying a system in South Korea that we don't even know whether it works. Second, those who know these things indicate clearly that a missile defense system in South Korea will not be able to defend Seoul against North Korean missiles, even if it worked. Because the launch to target time from North Korea to Seoul is simply too short for a missile defense system to intercept these missiles. We're not putting it in there to defend Seoul. Well, we also want a radar system in there that can cover much of China. So maybe we're putting it in there to cover China. Well, the problem with that is it'd be ineffective against China. Because missile defense missiles are so much more expensive than intercontinental ballistic missiles. And China has so many ways to defeat a missile defense system that they're really not worried about it strategically. China said very clearly, what's the problem with this is it's political. The United States is using missile defense to compel South Korea to decide whose side are you on? Our side, in which case you'll take THAAD, or the Chinese side, they don't want you to take it. Where are you? And why are we doing this? We're doing this to say clearly that we resist Chinese influence in South Korea, and we have the diplomatic military resolve to resist, even as our capabilities are declining. You also see this in Vietnam. The United States wants to develop a defense relationship with Vietnam. This is a fool's errand. We think that our Navy can help support Vietnamese security. No, Vietnam is a land theater. 1.3 billion Chinese on the north side of the Vietnamese border. There is nothing the United States can do to offset that massive Chinese strategic superiority. Since the end of the Cold War, the Vietnamese have done nothing to upgrade their army. The Chinese, this is a very effective advance ground force today. And the Vietnamese know it. Every time the Chinese get a little testy and they say, what are you doing with this island dispute? The Vietnamese say, well, you know, tell us what's important to you and, you know, we won't challenge it. But we insist on developing a defense relationship with Vietnam that can enhance American security. Well, we're showing how tough we are. We can stick it to China. This is what declining great powers do, is they use diplomacy to offset decline with a more louder, noisier diplomacy. You see this in the Philippines. We're increasing our defense presence in the Philippines, even though we think that during wartime we won't have any access to the Philippines. And this has the Navy somewhat concerned, because all these things we do inside the South China Sea with the Philippines and Singapore are really expensive. And all the naval operations we do inside the South China Sea are very expensive. They spend 75% of their time inside the South China Sea, but they don't plan to fight in the South China Sea. So we're using these deployments to consolidate an alliance to resist China's rise rather than to enhance America's warfighting capability. Second, we supported the Philippines over the law of the sea. Now, I mean, two things here. Let's establish clearly. These islands are worthless. There is no oil, no natural resources anywhere around these islands. There's oil, natural resources, off the coast of the countries, Vietnam, Philippines. But once you get off the coast in the vicinity of these islands, there is no oil, no gas, nothing. Second, these islands are all too small to have any wartime significance. They are unmovable aircraft carriers that can be destroyed relatively easily and flooded once they're hit. So what's in that part of the world are fish. And, you know, God forbid America develops a security policy over fish. But we supported the Philippines to resist China's claims and to go to the international law of the sea and the Court of Permanent Arbitration to challenge China over access, over who controls these islands. Well, one, they're worthless islands. And two, did anyone really think that taking China to the International Court of Arbitration, Permanent Court of Arbitration, was going to make a difference? They were going to listen to a court ruling in international law? After all, we ignore international law all the time we want. Great powers don't follow international law. We took them there anyway. And why do they do that? Because this is a way to isolate China, show our support for the Philippines, and show our resolve to China. The end result, China lost, Philippines won, and China in the court, but China won the battle. Because now both the Philippines and Vietnam have gone to China and say, oh, that's nice, we want it, now let's get down to business again. We'll use this as the basis for negotiations with you. But where we go in the future, we'll have to negotiate that bilaterally. All we accomplished was 3 years of heightened tension in the South China Sea as China was determined to punish the Philippines for doing what China told them not to do, internationalize the maritime disputes. We see this with Japan. The United States is encouraging Japan to play a higher naval role in South China Sea. Japan is developing naval cooperation with the Philippines and Vietnam. Again, this is worthless. The Chinese Navy and Air Force is already putting significant pressure on Japan in the East China Sea, so that Japan has its hands full over the disputed territories and Chinese challenges in the East China Sea. It can't move its Navy down to the South China Sea and do anything significant. And every time they do, you know what the Chinese do? Oh, they do a little more intrusions into 12 miles, and they do a little more air flights approaching Japanese airspace to underscore to Japan, you want to play around the South China Sea? We'll make your life miserable in the East China Sea. So why are we doing this? Well, we want to stick it to the Chinese by using Japan, which the Chinese people have great resentment toward from World War II, heightened nationalism, to show the Chinese that we're prepared to do everything possible to resist your rise. And all it does is make the Chinese less interested in cooperation, but more important, stimulates anti-Japanese nationalism. Well, all these things do nothing to contribute to American security, but they all signal American resolve at the diplomatic level. What we also see in Chinese diplomacy, classic behavior of a rising power. It's using its greater power to demand more. We now want greater security. You drew the East Asia Maritime Security Order and we didn't have a Navy. We now have a Navy. We want more security. Look at the list of things the Chinese have done. This is what China did in 2 years, less than 2 years, 2012 to late 2013. They challenged Japanese sovereignty by moving their ships into 12 miles on and off in the East China Sea. They challenged the Philippines and South China Sea over Huang Yindao and then proceeded to occupy it and control it. They started drilling for the first time in oil in disputed waters in the South China Sea. They announced an air defense identification zone in the East China Sea. They increased their surveillance of U.S. maritime operations in the South China Sea, closer and more often against U.S. ships and aircraft. And they began construction in 2013 of those seven islands in the South China Sea. Not one island, not two islands, but seven at once. And not small constructions, but big constructions. This looks to be a country in a hurry. All this is when China encountered resistance from the United States. They didn't say, oh, we need to back off. When they encountered all that resistance from the United States, they said, no, we're a great power now. We don't back down. And they pushed harder and harder and faster, so the U.S.-China relationship ratcheted up. In South Korea, you put THAAD in South Korea, the Chinese made clear, don't ask for our cooperation versus North Korea. We told you don't put THAAD into South Korea. Well, now you come to us and ask for more sanctions against North Korea? No, that's not the way it works. So the price that China is imposing on the United States for THAAD is less cooperation in North Korea, not more cooperation. In the past, they may have seen a threat from American presidents and said, we need a compromise. Now they're not compromising. And South Korea is squirming all the more because the signal to South Korea is, well, maybe that restraint that's been constraining North Korea all these years, maybe it's a little less now. Is that where you want to be? And of course, with Japan, again, as I said before, when Japan operates in the South China Sea, they just increase the pressure on Japan in the East China Sea. So what has China done? If the United States, with its efforts, have persuaded China our number one objective is containment, and there's enough evidence for them to see it, strategic containment, not Cold War containment, but strategic containment, we've given them enough evidence to say that's our objective. China's given us enough evidence to say that they have unrestrained and destabilizing objectives. They are an expansionist state. And they've given us every reason to believe that with those 2 years of very heightened activity. This was the expected dynamics of great powers in a power transition as the gap in relative power begins to narrow and you reach that nexus where the two trend lines begin to intersect. This is heightened great power tension over regional security, and I assure you it will get worse, not better. Because that gap will narrow as trends in U.S. and Chinese naval capabilities narrow, as that gap narrows, giving China greater confidence to challenge and American greater insecurity. Now, what are the implications for war and peace? All right. Well, we have to worry about war, right? In history, we worry about the status quo power using war to abort the trend. We worry about the resistance power once it has an advantage to oppose resistance. Well, Chinese are already talking about a period of danger, just like Tirpitz did in the early 20th century when he was building his dreadnoughts and he was afraid of a British Copenhagen against the German fleet. Chinese are talking about a period of danger with the U.S. using the islands in the South China Sea as a pretext to start a war. When we say to the Chinese, you should exercise restraint, the Chinese say, we have been exercising restraint. We haven't gone to war against Vietnam and the Philippines. I mean, that's where they are, where, you know, they're quite feeling their oats, and they think, that's restraint. How about on the American side? Well, the Americans are concerned, if the Chinese are concerned about a period of danger, this Supreme Court, this Permanent Court of Arbitration, as it reached its decision time, Americans kept predicting a Chinese attack on the Philippines that would start a war because the Chinese wanted to challenge our alliances. At the same time, Chinese aren't saying we are exercising restraint. Many Americans are talking about we need to establish a red line on the Chinese. They've been pushing us around South China Sea, Huangyandao, pushing us around on these islands. We need to establish a red line. We need to let them know when to stop. And many in Washington are frustrated because China's provocations are just below the level where we would have reason to go to war. And they say, oh, China's been very smart. They've been keeping this below, you know, below any provocation that could be a challenge to American security. So you see both sides talking in ways that they're experiencing danger and they're getting frustrated at restraint. And it's not a good place to be. So the tension's growing. Well, let's talk about things that might keep the peace in the political science literature. You read Ken Waltz. What does Ken Waltz tell us? Bipolarity is good for peace because with bipolarity, the great powers know where the threat comes from, and they maintain such jealousy over security, you never get such an imbalance that you have to go to war to correct the balance. You know, that's a nice theory, but guess what? Maintaining a balance of power is more than simply having bipolarity. You look at it matters about what you can do, imagine your domestic political system, imagine where at what time the rising power is coming, relative capabilities in terms of domestic capacity. Yes, we're bipolar, but I wouldn't trust the bipolar system to keep that relatively stable distribution of power, because clearly the United States has not done a good job in maintaining, for its part, stability in the distribution of power. And China is closing that gap, and the trends suggest that it will get stronger relative to the United States, not weaker. Second, what about nuclear weapons geography in war? Well, we're familiar with the literature on the nuclear peace. And that conventional wars are deterred by the threat of escalation of nuclear war. I would suggest that is a theory, much like bipolarity in peace, is a theory based upon the Cold War experience. And in much of this literature, there is what I would call a Cold War, a European bias, coming from our case studies of Europe. A conventional ground war in Europe would have been existential to France and to Germany. They could have disappeared of an onslaught of the Soviet army into their territory. After all, Bismarck was in there quick. After all, Hitler's army got in there quick. And so with a ground war that could determine the fate of Germany, West Germany, and France overnight, the threat of escalation in nuclear war was very real. That's not Asia. This is a naval theater, not a ground force theater. The risk of war, of a conventional war that doesn't go nuclear in a naval theater, is you're going to lose some ships. As American admirals have said, all right, I'll lose an aircraft carrier. Who cares? And what he means by that is that people die in war. Ships get sunk in war. We're preparing to fight a war. We're going to take costs. But what he also meant was this is not losing a country. This is not losing France. This is not losing Germany. So the risk of escalation is worse. And the feeling could be that war can be contained in a maritime environment. So the potential for conventional war is far greater in a nuclear environment in a maritime theater than it is in a mainland theater. If there's a war at sea, Chinese aren't worried about us landing in Tianjin and marching into Beijing. And we're not worried about them marching into, sailing to Hawaii and landing in Hawaii. But the Russians and the French and the West Germans worried about the survival of France and West Germany. So in both cases, bipolarity and nuclear weapons, there's a European bias reflecting case study, Cold War, European theater. Now, there's also implications here for crisis and stability in the great power relationship. I mentioned earlier that the Chinese will not be able to get their ships out of the South China Sea, their submarines. And the United States won't be able to get their submarines into the South China Sea. Well, what does that mean? As a crisis develops, each side is going to rush to get their ships in there first before the war starts, and each side can set up a picket fence. So you can imagine, sort of playing out World War I in Europe, and you can imagine that as the crisis develops, the United States starts moving its submarines real quick into the South China Sea. So they're there already. And the Chinese want to get their ships out of the South China Sea so they can look for aircraft carriers once the war starts. And so you begin to have this heightened tension over survival of ships and first strike capability because of the necessity to get ships out or get ships in before the war starts. So, deterministic theories of war, I think, are misleading and incorrect. The factors that cause war are multiple: leadership, wise leadership; risky leadership; risk propensity; cautious leadership; nationalism, both in the part of leaders and or publics; and the relationship to domestic instability and the pressure that leaderships can face from public nationalism. Civil-military relations, which, if a bit of a surprise, the Chinese have done a better job at civil-military relations than the United States has done the last couple of years. But the point being is that ship commanders at sea have an awful lot of latitude in making decisions because they don't often have time to get instructions when other ships are approaching at a high speed. So one worries about civil-military relations. So the risk of war is growing, and we see it associated with strategic war planning. We see it associated with great power diplomacy. And as I say to some people, if you're religious, you pray for good leadership. If you're not, you hope. Thank you. Sure. I should say that I've been optimistic about U.S.-China relations for the last 30 years. And when I watched the trends in ship production, everything changed.
And when you call them, you just tell us who you are.
Well, that's Alexander Wendt, so I can call him.
There are so many things.
Yes, I put a lot on the table. I definitely did. Yes.
Just a couple of comments and a question. Between these two countries, it's so fundamentally different. It's so much, it's so profound that mm-hmm. war between these two countries would be essentially suicidal, especially in the 90s. So I think that characterization of the relationship is kind of weird. But in a way, that relates to my larger point, which is that your whole analysis was completely military.
Yes.
It's not political.
No.
It's not economic.
No.
It's not ideological. It's all 19th century balance of power.
Yes.
Capability kind of stuff. Right around the
corner, 1913. No, I didn't say that.
Okay, it's 1911. I look at the world, I just don't see this at all.
Let's say 1908.
But that's, I don't see this at all. And I guess when you say that, here's the sort of the comment or the question I want to make, which is that you say that China's challenging Japanese sovereignty, right? I don't think they're challenging Japanese sovereignty. They're having an elaborate kabuki play with the Japanese, right? It's all staging. All play symbolic politics to demands. But if you ever actually push the Chinese on something, they're going to back off in a hurry. And I think that's probably going to be true for 10 more years, 20 more years. I just don't see the scenario that I see a lot of posturing and not a lot of real hard politics.
Well, let's say a couple of things. One, you know the arguments as well as I do about interdependence. Yeah, so, you know, Europe was more interdependent at any time in 1912 than it was until the 1970s, and that didn't do much good. The two great powers that were most interdependent in 1912 were France and Germany, and that didn't do much good. Second, now all that interdependence didn't prevent us from getting where we are today, so why are you confident they're going to stop us from going down the road any further? You know, Chinese defense budget has grown 11% a year. They don't seem to care about interdependence. Well, no, the point, there are larger issues there, but there are larger issues there, but, and that is, why do we care about the Chinese? And that's a more first order principle question that is worth discussing and should be discussed. In our national security debate, we don't discuss it, but I believe it's worth it. And then embedded in that is it really worth a war? But we don't discuss that issue. But when I say war, When we talk about power transition wars, we talk about World War I, World War II in Europe, World War II in Asia. We talk about Napoleonic Wars. We talk about wars of Louis XIV. If there's a war, and the likelihood, I can't predict the likelihood, let's say 10,000 U.S. casualties. That's not that many more than Afghanistan and Iraq. And our country doesn't seem to care about those casualties. I find that atrocious, by the way, that those two wars have never been part of our national elections, that we're oblivious to Americans dying. But all I can say is, if that's the kind of war it is, in the scheme of great power history, that's something America seems able to deal with. As far as Japan, sovereignty, you know, countries have fought wars over sovereignty. So the way I like to think of interdependence is not that it stops wars, but it raises the threshold at which countries go to war. And that makes me somewhat more optimistic in that it gives politicians more time to deal with the problems they're dealing with, the jump to go to war is less. But it doesn't take it off the horizon. And I think it behooves us to focus on that, because if you bury your head in the sand, or if you say it's never going to happen, you're not playing your role as a concerned citizen to prevent it from happening.
Yeah, I think a series of like three questions.
Three. All right. One, two, three. All right. Four.
Enjoyed the talk. It was heartening at the end to hear you say that you have been historically an optimist.
Yes.
Because I just told my foreign policy class to come to this talk, and I said, yeah, he's a realist optimist.
That's what Aaron Friedberg targeted me as, an optimistic realist. And that's right. Yeah, that's right.
I guess the question that's lingering with me is related to Alex's, but let's say I accept everything that you said and more, and I think that China's, power is growing astronomically, and say the U.S. decides to accelerate these trends and really go, into a withdrawal.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
So we see power in the Pacific to China. I'm still not quite sure what the risk and danger is. What are they, in other words, what would China change?
Right. This is the real... Trade they're not going to change.
We don't promote democracy. What are they going to change?
That is the most important question, because that should determine how we go about responding to the rise of China. So, an abbreviated discourse on American grand strategy from 1776. Since 1776, American security has been predicated on divided flanks. Every time the United States faced a European threat, or every time we expanded American territory, it was because the Europeans were fighting amongst themselves. We wouldn't have won the Revolutionary War if the French and the British weren't at each other's throats. We intervened in World War I and World War II because we concluded the Europeans can't keep themselves divided, so we got to keep it divided. So we had an interest in fighting World War II in Asia for the same reason. We keep our flanks divided to keep America safe. Fundamental to that was the threat of conventional war coming to America. Presumably that threat just doesn't exist in the world of nuclear weapons. If there's ever a credible use of nuclear weapons, it should have come if someone wants to attack the American territory. So the imperative to keep those flanks divided should be considerably less. Get American leaders and statesmen to think that way is really hard. It's ingrained on them that the balance of power in Asia is fundamental and our security is at stake. But the second thing is, you could have said that about China. Well, the fact is that because America dominated the Western Hemisphere, we had our ability to have power projection in Asia. And what did we do? We fought a war in North Korea. We fought a war in Vietnam, creating hot wars right on Chinese borders. And that wasn't that long ago, and it was a nuclear world. And they saw that as a major threat to their security. So you have to ask, would China want to come over here and do that to us? I can't imagine why they would, but if we wanted to do it to them, maybe they would want to do it to us. Now, personally, I don't think it's worth the candle. And I think we live in a world where we're fortunate enough to have security in the Western Hemisphere, and that's good enough. And it's not worth a war. But try persuading that to the admirals. Try persuading that to Congress. So many of the dynamics we're seeing are traditional dynamics because of traditional thinking. What's that?
We could
have our interests wrong, simply put, right? And after all, there's a long history of leaders having expansive interests that led to catastrophic events when their country would have been happy with less expansive objectives. That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
First, thank you and happy to inform you. You mentioned early on, you asked the question, what does China want? And I'm still trying to figure out how that fits in exactly with the issues you raised. It seems to me that right now, the benefit that China gets out of this nationalist posturing, revisionism, however you want to characterize mm-hmm. it, that really doesn't have a domestic downside. In fact, they're just getting a lot of positive things from nationalism and domestic politics. Mm-hmm. But I think you brought up very, very correctly, America has learned that even with a tremendous resource advantage, that stuff can go out the window when people start dying in significant numbers. Mm. Learn this repeatedly and painfully.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm wondering, what about, you mentioned the U.S., you know, is it really worth it to fight this war with China? That's a question we should be asking ourselves, and I agree. I wonder how that question is in the Chinese context. I mean, I believe that the Chinese leadership is very centrally focused on domestic threat, mm-hmm. on the idea of, you know, being pushed out of town. Are they willing to risk a naval confrontation with the United States that might do a lot of damage when they know, I mean, they're never going to be able to existentially threaten the United States with a naval war any more than we can invade and occupy China, mm-hmm. but that might not be the only risk that the Chinese government is looking at. If they get into a war and it goes much more poorly than they expect,
That's right.
What are they worried about?
Two things. You're right about America has discovered repeatedly that once people start dying at significant rates, we don't want to continue the war through victory.
That's right.
And it seems to be a pattern in American military policy. However, the story the American military tells itself is they sink a carrier, boy, where do you see American resolve? Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but that's the story we tell ourselves. On the Chinese side, well, it's a question whether you win or not. Right? The Communist Party doesn't want to lose. They lose, they're going down real fast. And that's one of the reasons they've been deterred about Taiwan. You don't want to attack Taiwan, try and unify and have Taiwan beat you. You don't want to go there. And it's a hard nut to crack. Landing on Taiwan would be much more difficult than landing in Normandy, for example. So that's one of the things that deters them from even thinking about it. Another thing that deters them, by the way, is that Taiwan is getting very good surface-to-air missiles and surface-to-ship missiles, so a war over Taiwan would deplete the Chinese military, so they have to rebuild to deal with us. Not something they want to do, right? They have to calculate carefully whether they can win. So that's why when I looked at this, you know, what the two drivers of war, it's the status quo power that wants to abort the trend, and the revisionist power who, after they've crossed that line, waits until it knows it can win, and then is tired of the opposition and wants to get out of the way. But you have to get down that road. Now, added just as a clarifying point, all this is premised on the Chinese, how should we say, maintaining some level of moderate economic growth. There is no guarantee of that. They have screwed up their economy so bad, and I don't think they're ever going to recover. Because of what you were saying, the price of recovery is domestic instability. They've got to go through a 1 or 2% growth to recover, maybe 3. And the amount of unemployment that does to that country, they're addicted to stimulus. One of the nice things about America is that if a president loses an election, he gets a $20 million contract for his book. In China, if you get domestic instability and you lose your position, you get a bullet in your head. That tends to increase the political content to economic policy, right? So it's all sort of predicated on that assumption. And I would suggest that at the minimal, the investment climate in China will deteriorate significantly. That will undermine their ability to maintain technological modernization.
Yeah. Two questions. First, a follow-up. Christopher Brown from the Classics Department.
Sorry.
your last comment about the technological, economic crisis facing China, you mentioned in your remarks that the U.S. technological superiority in the military field declining.
Yes.
But isn't the technological economic advantage of the United States still substantial? And second question, you talk about the thinking in terms of if they were to do what we do, but we have a lot of evidence that the Chinese think very differently about military force historically. They don't have this Indo-European heritage of a military caste. If we look, for example, at Africa, we see the United States moving in militarily with AFRICOM. You see the Chinese coming in to do business, and that seems to reflect in general their military posture.
Okay, first on First on technology. The Russian economy was a basket case. And they had no real good technology in their civilian economy. But when they focused on something that had military technology that mattered, they could do a good job. So we have to be cautious that despite economic disruptions, the Chinese can't develop technology. Related, if you look at what the U.S. is trying to do on technology, it's a basket case. Look, we got this little combat ship that's costing us a fortune, that all four of them are now back in port because they don't work. DOD is dysfunctional, and that's not an overly strong statement. They are paying so much for ships because the acquisition process is broken. Then they put them out to sea quickly because they spent so much, they want to get them out to sea, and they're getting out to sea before they're even ready. Same thing with the latest destroyer, the Zumwalt, that's having issues. We just aren't in, but having said that, we're working on laser capabilities, a railgun. We're working on underwater unmanned vehicles. This stuff is pretty science fiction. We'll get some of it. But in the meantime, what the existing technologies, the Chinese will do a good job of catching up. Now, the catching up's too strong. They will close the gap. And they're focusing on certain capabilities. So you can't defend against a DF-21C that can attack Singapore. You can't put missile defense in Singapore. There is no defense against that missile. And now it's got 15 feet circular probability. So you don't have to match our technology to degrade our capabilities. That's all. And they're doing a good job of focusing what needs to be done. You know, they build four and they stop. They build four and they stop. They build four and they stop. Oh, now we got what we want to build a lot. They didn't, I mean, you know, give them credit. They took every loan from the international institutions and soft loans, and they built infrastructure. Give India money, what do they do with it? No one knows. This was a very effective government that knew what it was doing for a long time. And they're now deploying weapons that may not be equal to ours, but are effective in doing what they need to do. Yeah.
Sure, thank you very much. Yeah. My name is Andy Gunnard. I'm a political science graduate student. I wonder, you paint sort of two trend lines, right? One is the really negative trend of, you know, how quickly the gap is closing.
Yes.
The other is where there might be some weaknesses in the Chinese state that maybe, you know,
yes,
work in our favor. I guess if you're a U.S. strategist, where does that put you? Do you sort of proactively pull back from alliance commitments or cut a deal before you have to
Yeah.
Where do you play out some of this?
You know, that's a very hard question. So I said earlier, the U.S. Navy assumes that they won't have access to Singapore, the Philippines, Malaysia. Well, why are we spending a fortune consolidating our commitment to them with greater military capabilities that are so expensive? Because if we don't consolidate our military relationship with them, they will fall into China's lap. So it's a very, and if you want to keep them on your side, you got to do what you're doing, even though there's no wartime significance. And this is a struggle in the military, is what you do here. I think the larger question goes back to the earlier question, why are we there and do we need to be there? If you make an a priori decision that we don't need to dominate the maritime regions, that will drive your policy toward Philippines and Singapore, not what's going on in China, that's all. And, you know, there are two kinds of realisms, let's put it this way. There's a Bismarck realism. Oh, Russia and Prussia have a problem over Poland. Well, let's get this problem off the table. We'll cut it in half. There's the American kind of realism. We're not giving you something until you can take it. And that's where we are, right? So we're doing all this because, you know, until you can take it, we're not giving it. That may not be sustainable, that's all. I'm sorry, I didn't ask the earlier question back there on military and everything else. On Africa. Chinese aren't doing military in Africa because they can't. They have no facilities in Africa. They have no Air Force that can reach Africa. Their Navy has a minimal force that can go into Africa. And they don't want to take their Navy and their most modern abilities and deploy them in the Western Indian Ocean when the Americans have all their capabilities in the South China Sea and moving more. You know, we talk about Chinese bases in Djibouti and in Pakistan. Nonsense. You don't have a base unless you can guarantee access during wartime. And they can't guarantee access during wartime because they don't have the power projection off the coast of Pakistan or off the coast of the Persian Gulf. So that's going to be worthless. That's not an asset. Try getting in there during wartime when the United States will dominate those waters. America has a base in the Philippines, not because we have an agreement with the Philippines, but because we can defend that base. Now we can't defend it. The alliance is irrelevant. If we can't defend that base, then that base is not a base anymore. So that's where the Chinese are in Africa. And is it all military? Yeah, you know, this is sort of going back to Alex's question. Chinese think militarily too. What makes China distinct in their long history is that, oh, this is the old thing about China. China didn't use military power against South Korea, except once during the Ming, or against Vietnam once during the Ming, because they had nowhere else to go. And so they were going to accommodate the Central Kingdom. But boy, they knew a lot about military power, and they dealt with the nomads in the Central Asian steppe, because they couldn't defeat them and they had a place to go. They kept retreating into the center and they come back and fight. So they built huge land armies. And they built a great wall in order to try and defeat nomadic armies in the north. They have a very fine military tradition and they know how to fight wars and they focus on fighting wars. Yeah. Okay, yeah, sorry. Yeah. You didn't.
I really appreciate your talk. I'm sensing a change of both, I think, perhaps more than anybody else, I've read almost everything Bob has been long time friend. And the change is too pessimistic about U.S. power.
Yeah.
And a little bit more, kind of like the, I think the assessment of China is largely based on hardware capability, which reminds me of General Park. I just finished a couple of years in U.S. Army War College there, so it's very reminiscent of the General's talk. I'm wondering why, as a political scientist, China scholar, now you focus on hardware, those
rather than
stats, but not intentions, strategic kind of a culture, those things that perhaps more important for any country, China or anywhere else. To why such a focus on those quantitative things? And there are two, as a China scholar, I think you choose Germany as a reference point. And somehow I see, and I don't know why you conveniently ignore both long-term history, like China was the biggest naval power in the 14th century and the 15th century, and China chose to stay at home. Whether China was super smart or stupid is the question. Secondly, in the past 37 years, China's economy grows average almost 10%, and the last war China fought actually 1979. And
78.
Right? Never stopped fighting.
Yes, it's true. Yes.
So the capability of China's rise is one thing, but the intentions, cultures, other histories is actually equally important. Now, the rise of China first and foremost is an economic rise. Now, the pivot to Asia Pacific was largely militarized. These are asymmetrical strategies. How do you reconcile these two things? I'm not saying China is a better country than a peaceful. China is a different country.
Okay, let me.
That's my biggest question.
First
China
about. Oh, I'm sorry. That was three questions, by the way.
You're to the top.
Yes?
You never mentioned the non first use. China is the only nuclear power that has, from day one, adopted non first use. Obama tried to move away from the first use. It basically failed as a Nobel person. It is pathetic, actually. So how do you put those things together? The part of the software?
First thing. China is a mainland power throughout its history. No, the one time under the Yongzheng Emperor, it built its navy. Why does China stop building its navy? Because it faced nomadic attacks from the north and had a war in Vietnam. Oh, China had continental challenges that prevented it from becoming a maritime power, much like Germany or France or Russia. Oh, now China conquers the entire mainland, now it can build a navy. So strategic environment matters, that's all. The Yongzheng Emperor abandoned the Navy because they were draining the budget and fighting two wars on land. So we see this is not a culture, this is the implications of strategic environment dictating how you spend money in your defense strategy. Intentions. I would suggest to you that what drives international conflict is that countries don't have confidence in understanding other countries' intentions. Leaders lie. They don't tell you, I'm going to attack you tomorrow, but they may attack you tomorrow. Intentions change as leaders change. If you thought that Bill Clinton's policy toward Iraq would extend to the Bush administration, well, you were in for a serious problem if you were a leader of Iraq. And of course, domestic and international circumstances can change. Domestic instability leading to nationalism or changes in the international environment that can make a greater threat perception. So what drives all this is not intentions, but capabilities. Second, there's a underlying understanding that capabilities drive intentions. China's intentions were very moderate during Deng Xiaoping's era because they didn't have a navy. Well, now why is China building this huge navy if it doesn't want to change things? If it were happy with the status quo, it wouldn't be building a navy. It wouldn't be building 11% a year. This is a country that wants more capabilities. It's not just so they can be happy with their ships and sailing around the world. They want to use those ships for something. They want greater security vis-a-vis the United States. I would suggest to you that's a perfectly understandable objective. I wouldn't call that expansionist. I wouldn't call it aggressive. I would simply say the United States and China have a conflict of interest. You know, that's not unusual. Randy chimes in, right? Yeah.
As we get older, we're coming together. So, that said, first of all, it seems to be a power transition. We haven't had a great power war in 71 years. So I think you have to address at least the issue of, isn't the power transition, the whole hegemonic war cycle, dead? And if it's dead, what does that tell you, right? And second, the Cold War analogy, I think, go to what Al's saying. Like, the Cold War was an ideological battle, and the Soviets didn't owe us $1.4 trillion. They weren't our largest market, and we weren't their largest market. And so, you know, there's a lot that's different. I mean, when you were covering North Korea and Vietnam, that was in the context of a Cold War, which doesn't exist anymore. So you don't have that. They're apples. And then finally, so that needs to be addressed, I think. Then 20 years ago, I think,